Jodie is an employment lawyer who has noticed a rise in people being sacked because of their OnlyFans.
So I've heard about some people in these situations being actually shown the images, even where they've accepted that it was them. In my view, there's no need to really do that. I don't see the point of showing someone the explicit images when they accept they have the account, they accept they know what the content is. So certainly there could be an argument of breach of privacy because it's not on the public internet in the sense of, you know, not anybody can access it, it's behind a paywall. The key thing is whether it influences or impacts detrimentally their 9-to-5 job. So there is the principle of, you know, we should be able to do what we want in our personal lives, but where the personal life may then detrimentally impact the professional life of the 9-to-5, that's where we can start to see employers, you know, taking action against people with these alternative incomes. What damages one particular reputation of an organisation is going to be very different to another. So in my view, it's quite subjective, and it really does depend on, you know, what they're saying is the damage and how. So for example, it might be that it's linked to an account that all of the clients have access to. In that case, they might be able to argue that. But if it's behind a paywall, you can't identify the individual, it's difficult to say how that would cause reputational damage.
Because you, as I said, were involved in that thematic review, yeah. and you know, it was really great to have your input into that. And I know from our previous conversations that, you know, you see workplace culture as something, it's not just a compliance issue, but as Tony said, but also as something that can really add value for clients and staff. So I just wondered if you could tell us a little bit about any top tips for, yeah, you know, building a good culture in a growing firm, but also any tips for overcoming any challenges that you saw.
Yeah, for sure. So I launched Thrive 5 years ago on my own. We're a small firm, and we don't have a kind of head of well-being or a head of HR. In fact, we don't have a HR person, that's me. So for me, it was all about role modeling behaviors and making sure that I was practicing what I preached. Certainly sharing my own story of having mental health struggles has helped my team. And recently we were featured in the ACAS guidance as a case study, because one of my staffs now shared her story and said how actually in her interview for Thrive, she told me she had a panic attack on the way. And so creating that culture right from the outset for me was of paramount importance, partly for me to feel like I was safe in my own firm, but also for me to create a firm that had a positive culture that would attract people who shared those values.
And Jodie, obviously you've approached this in a very different way, and I don't know if you wanted to say a few words about how that works in your firm.
Yeah, for sure. It's similar to what Elizabeth was saying. We don't actually monitor people based on hours billed. We monitor on output. So there is a financial target, but it's different to a billable hours financial target. And they're also monitored on behaviours, where the whole firm actually on a monthly basis will score each other on a 360. And the scores are weighted, and we collectively created that. So it was, these are the values that are important, these are behaviors that we want to see. And so even if someone is a really good biller and is smashing their targets financially, unless they display the behaviors that support the positive workplace culture, they're not eligible for bonus. So we're linking all of that together and having this as a people first, behavior first approach rather than a finance first approach.
We talk a lot on this show about looking after your head, and this week it's Mental Health Awareness Week, so we thought we'd have a chat about well-being at work. And here to answer all your questions is solicitor Jodie Hill, who specialises in employment law. And I know, Jodie, this is actually a topic that's really close to your heart as well, isn't it?
Yeah, massively. I mean, I am really open about the fact that 4 or 5 years ago I had a mental breakdown and I was forced to leave my job. I suffered with PTSD and anxiety, and I just felt like I couldn't stay in the workplace that I was in. And that took me on a bit of a journey in actually setting up my own law firm and creating an employment law firm, as you say.
Yeah.
But one that really focuses on mental health, on these really important topics.
Yeah, and I can imagine it's probably something that people worry about talking to their employers about. So how do you approach that, having that conversation with your boss about your mental health?
Yeah, I think people are getting used to having those conversations a little bit more, but it's still really difficult. I mean, I know firsthand how difficult it was for me. But ultimately, you know, we're all in this together. Everybody has mental health, and at any point our mental health can decline. And, you know, your boss could have mental health problems. So think about that to start with, to give yourself a bit of confidence. But ultimately, the best thing that you can do is prepare for a meeting, put something in a diary with a manager who's really supportive, who you know will listen to you, and go in there prepared, knowing exactly
what you want them to do. So, you know, if it might be, I don't know, changing your working hours or giving you a bit of time off. So understanding what the impact is of your mental health on those, on your workplace, and actually then giving you the opportunity to agree something moving forward.
Employment lawyer Jodie Hill is here for this week's Consumer Corner to answer everything you need to know when it comes to taking time off. Interesting this. Why do you think sickness is at an all-time high then?
So I think it's probably linked to COVID. If you look at the stats, it was 5.8 days per employee per year that was the average, and now it's 7.8. So that's the difference between the pandemic and now. But we're also seeing the issues around like cost of living crisis and stress being reported as some of the main reasons, as well as minor injuries and short-term absences. So like lots of little absences rather than necessarily like one long-term absence. Yeah. So if you're sick for the first 7 days, you can do what's called a self-certification. So contact your employer and confirm exactly what your reason for your sickness is and how long you're likely to be off. It might be that you have to do that daily, or you might do that and provide a sick note, which is the other form of evidence that you can give, and you could get that from your doctor. And actually, since the pandemic, it's helpful because you can now get the sick notes electronically. Again, depends. I hate these answers, don't you? Yeah. But it does depend on the basis of why you're off sick, how long you're off for, and what the reason is. So again, check your policies, because usually they'll tell you exactly how they'll contact you, so whether that's by phone or by email. And be mindful as well, if people are off on long-term sick with mental health issues, for example, they can ask for that frequency and method of communication to be changed. Hi, everyone. So, as you know, I'm going to talk to you about mental health. I'm going to start by waking up a little bit with some statistics. Did you know that suicide is the biggest killer of men under 45 in the UK? Did you know that poor mental health costs the UK employers £45 billion every single year? And did you know that 1 in 15 junior lawyers in the UK have contemplated suicide in the last 14 days? Now, this is in the 21st century, which to me just blows my mind. But equally, this was pre-pandemic. So in my view, I actually think these statistics are probably going to get worse. So it's something that we need to address and we need to start talking about. I'm just going to share you a little story about my journey and why I care so much about mental health. And basically, I have anxiety. I've suffered with post-traumatic stress disorder. And I had a mental breakdown 2.5 years ago. And I talk openly about it now. I can talk to you here today. But, you know, that was a really, really difficult time. As a solicitor, I was, you know, at the top of my game. I was the top performer. But ultimately, things just got... I couldn't cope anymore. I was on medication. I was having therapy. But I was in an environment that didn't support my mental health. I was in an environment where I couldn't thrive, where I couldn't be myself. And what that meant for me was I ended up having a long-term sickness absence. Now, I'd never had a sick day before, even with anxiety my whole life. I'd never had a sick day before, so that really irritated me. And I actually started to feel really guilty. I started to feel shame. I felt like I was letting people down. And for me, that was, you know, I felt like I lost my sense of purpose. Being a solicitor and actually being able to support people and to help them gave me a sense of purpose. It actually helped me stay mentally well.
Unlike race or gender, there's no specific law protecting people from weight discrimination. Leeds lawyer Jodie Hill says this can make it tricky for workers to take legal action.
You would have to try to argue is that, and obviously only if this was applicable, that it was linked to a disability. That would really be the only legal recourse from a discrimination perspective. Now, of course, people could say, well, it's bullying. It might be bullying harassment in the non-discriminatory context, but in forms of discrimination, it doesn't occur as a protected characteristic on its own.